Greetings, Internet. Today we're here with Gary Stern of Stern Pinball again. Today we're here at Stern Pinball, Curly Little Shop of Games in Fruitland Park, Florida, celebrating 15 years of pinball dealership. He's helped you set up at shows like IAPA and other conventions, right?
Yeah, you know, I go to some enthusiast events. Remember, this is the proceeds from this event are not for Curly or Little Shop, but they're going to Animal Rescue. And they have, besides the tickets to come, there are 200 tickets that sold very quickly. There are a lot of donations of food and everything else, play fields by us. A lot of raffles. So they'll raise some good money for charity. It's a charity event and a pinball event.
And a pinball event, IFPA pinball tournament.
Yeah.
Someone just won a Walking Dead pinball machine.
Yeah, Don won a Walking Dead pinball in the raffle. He won a pinball machine and he picked the Walking Dead.
And you were the lucky rabbit's foot because you're sitting right next to him.
I was sitting next to him, and then he pulled the ticket and he won. Right, that's it.
So that was pretty neat. They might do another today. Are there many distributors that have worked with you for 10 plus years or so?
Well, first of all, we distinguish between retailers and distributors. Distributors are sell mostly B2B, sell to operators, and dealers sell mostly B2C to the people who are here, end users. We have three different segments of market. I'm not answering your question yet.
Fair enough.
But we have operators and therefore players and locations worldwide, becoming more and more a location game again. We have collectors, enthusiasts that are here, and then we have what we call rec room buyers, somebody who is going to have one pinball machine. He played pinball when he was young and now he wants one, and he may never have two. He may trade his one in one day, but yeah, you know, he's told mommy is for the kids, and there it is in the house. So, as to companies that have been with us for 10 and 15 years, the commercial distributors are all mature companies. Some of our dealers are mature companies. That's why I distinguish, though, between dealers and distributors. The enthusiast business is newer than the commercial business, so there aren't as many that have been around as long. Many people have been with us for a lot of years. I don't know how many have been of the dealers have been with us for 15 years.
Is that segment of selling to homes growing pretty good?
All three segments are important. The operator segment is significantly growing and it's a big upside. We need to do better in that. The game companies are all had great years. We had a great year last year. Our pinball sales number of units was up 40%, largely because of the enthusiasts and the growth of commercial. There's a lot more work for commercial. The enthusiast market is growing a little, not at the rate of the others, but it's a very important market to us. The real growth potential is in the rec room buyers. We just need the right channel to sell to them. You know, you guys who are enthusiasts, You know a few people, you buy, some of you buy all over the country, some of you buy locally. You have somebody in Curly who is good to service, you take care of your problems, whatever. A lot of people who are enthusiasts just buy wherever, they take care of their own games. To really grow the rec room business, we need more places like Curly has here where people can come see a game. People aren't spending $6,000, $8,000, and $10,000 on something they've never touched. They want to touch it, and there is such a tremendous interest in pinball. George Gomez, who is our EVP of product development, had some friends who wanted a pinball machine. They were in Sarasota. The closest place they could come see a pinball was here, or find a barcade.
Right.
And they were ready to buy. You know, they certainly could afford a pinball machine. They were rec room buyers, but they didn't know what to buy because they didn't touch it. So the growth for us, and therefore the growth for the hobby, is by reaching this other group of people.
And it seems like every section is growing. I'm a collector operator. I do this for a living. Yeah. I make a living off quarters. Like, it's crazy. But
put bill heads in.
I still get a lot of quarters.
Sure you do.
A lot of places have change machines. That's a side note question. When is it getting to the point in the future where you're going to have credit card or pay with your phone? I know it's not like tomorrow or next year or
all of that's going to happen.
Going to happen.
Yes. The problem is that with the small vend that pinball play is, or a game play is, the percentage that the credit card companies want, which is large. Play Mechanics has a credit card pay system where they have gotten a very low rate, not much different than a regular store has. The other thing, though, that certainly, you know, iPay and all that is something to come. Again, the same problems. We're doing some work in China. Finally, going to introduce pinball to China, I believe. And in China, everything is with not what's up with
yuan.
WeChat. Everything is WeChat. They pay for everything with WeChat.
Okay.
Yeah. So games have to be on WeChat.
Okay. So you're on a mini vacation of sorts.
I wouldn't call it.
Did you do anything fun on the way to here or?
Well,
I here?
My Curly had kept my motorcycle down here, my Harley, okay. And so I came to. I had hoped to come back down. I sent it down for IAPA. We don't need it in Chicago in the winter,
right.
So I sent it down for IAPA. They have a charity bike ride, and I, you know, spent a number of days before that touring, shall we say. And I had hoped to go to Daytona Bike Week. You know, I was too busy. There were too many other events. But interesting, you see, Harley has a very similar situation to pinball. And that is, well, they don't have a commercial business, except for police departments, maybe. But they don't really have a commercial business. They have a core of enthusiasts, collectors, and then they have a lot of rec room buyers, a lot of guys who want a bike, they'll barely ride it, or they'll ride it once in a while, and they end up selling it. You can find some very low mileage bikes. I started as a rec room buyer. I probably am still, other than the study of it, I'm still not quite an enthusiast, although I do have two Harleys now. So it's very similar. I was down here to get my bike. I was down here to help somebody move somebody else's bike that's living in Athens and in its storage here. But particularly when I saw that this event, Curly was having this event again, he hasn't had it for the last few years, I said, we said, somebody's got to go, 15 years, this is a big celebration. And I said, well, that's me. I'll go to this one.
Yeah, thanks for coming down. It's a fun event. It's kind of like a family reunion of sorts of pinball people, because you have, that's basically every top 16 Florida-ranked players here, and the, you know, national champions here, Eric Stone. He won two in a row in Texas, so kind of putting us on the map for Florida pinball. Last year, Spider-Man Vault came out last year, and it turned out great.
Mm-hmm.
It's a beautiful game. It's a fun game. How well was that received overall?
Good. Overall, good. Good.
And will there be a new Vault in 2017?
You're not really asking me that and expect me to answer. I'm not going to. We don't talk about the future games.
You say maybe.
We talk about the great games we have now. And we do. I mean, people are just seeing Aerosmith, and our orders have skyrocketed as they've seen it in Texas. They've seen
it's a fun game.
Yeah, it's a fun game.
You can't explain how this. A lot of games you can kind of understand how it plays by looking at it, but this game you can't. You shoot the pop bumpers, it locks the ball. The ball flies, it hits Jackie in the face. It's just a really dynamic game.
It's just a great toy to watch it, you qualify it, open the toy box and get in the eject and throw it in there. It's just cool. For a casual player, think of that for a player that's not one of you guys, that is just, learning pinball.
Like that.
It's just wow. It's just cool. The game's fun. We have that here. We have the Batman 66s here. Which is just growing in popularity, especially as Lyman does new code for
it. That code is coming along. I know that it came out with like 0.6 something initially, which had a lot of characters in it.
Yeah.
But you can imagine in the future when all the characters
all
are
the
in
characters,
there.
That's right.
I mean, it's already, frankly, a deep game. Every game that comes out that's not complete, as collectors say, it's still a deep game that's not... You can't get there unless you're really, really good on a really lucky day.
Or take the glass off.
Or both. And but, you know, it takes a while to complete a game. And you know, is that the philosophy is to get it as far as you can? You have timelines for the games? Or
Lyman is, does, you know, his way. And he obviously makes fun games, successful games, you know, great games for you guys and so on. He's still working on this game. He's not done. He's got stuff to fill in yet that he wants to do. But every 2, 3, 4 weeks, we come out with a new code.
And yeah, Aerosmith, if you haven't played it, the photos online don't explain it. The footage online doesn't explain it.
Yeah.
It really is a unique game. And the animations are really fresh.
Yeah.
They're 70s. Great. They're groovy, but they're fun.
Yeah.
They kind of... Not exactly, but reminiscent of that animated movie Heavy Metal, where it's like it took the heavy metal kind of ish theme and environment, and it put it into animated. And Aerosmith, I don't know if they had any input in the game of things they want to do, but it really captured the toys flying around, like the Batman toy. That's just great.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's to me that game really, like, visually, it explains what's going on in the game, which are things you couldn't really do with just dots.
Yep.
Dots were good at explaining that you're in a mode, in what mode,
so
but it really is, if you're watching Aerosmith, it's encompassing.
There's so much more we can do with the LCD that we have done and we will do. Although understand that takes a major commitment in staff to do this.
You hired a lot of new people to up to this.
That, absolutely.
Previous people that worked on like Mortal Kombat and things like that, just that were, you know, they were specifically you know, geared for that. And you've hired new programmers, you've hired Keith Elwin.
Yeah.
What inspired that hire? He's the number one, like, best pinball player working on Archer. Really?
He was interested. He had made a pinball machine, Archer. He obviously has some talent. He knows pinball. He's operated games, and he understands that game operation isn't for you guys.
Right.
It's for the casual player, you know. So he understands that part of it. He's a young man, and we are going to continue making pinball way past my lifetime. So we need some young blood. He's great potential, great character. He's going to be great. George Gomez is mentoring him, and he's working on a game.
You have another great pinball player in house. You have to have Lyman Cheats is a really, really, really good pinball player, and so is Keith Elwin. So to have a really great pinball player, another in the house, so you can understand for the term aspect, but also, you know, to say, hey, well, this is for me.
Yeah.
Let's reverse it. What's for the casual player?
Yeah.
Because as an operator, I have to go to locations and I chat with the customer. What do you like? What don't you like? And it's that it's, you know, they can get better every time as opposed
so
to.
You were talking about a location in St. Augustine,
South of Philly.
South of Philly, it's a sandwich shop.
Yep.
The players in there, that's a tourist area. They're probably pretty casual players.
Very casual.
Yeah, and you need to make money with that game, so you need to get them to play more than once.
Correct.
So you need a game that's not for you only, but it's for them.
Right.
And you understand that. A lot of people don't understand that.
Right.
A lot of people think it's only for the collector enthusiast. We won't grow, and we won't have, for the hobby, we won't have new people if we don't have the casual player enjoying pinball too.
Right, new eyes. I mean, I see a parent and their kid play pinball, and it's touching, because usually the kids stare at the iPhone, parents stare at the iPad, or the Android phone, and they're all looking at a TV at this sports restaurant, and they're all disconnected. We have, you know, but then they go to play a pinball, and I'm like, that's great.
Uh-huh.
And sometimes I'll open a game, and a kid will look in there, I'm like, yeah, this is this, that's that, and it just, like, it's a spark in their head. You know, it's like, it's science, and it's interesting.
And the growth side, as much, we'll have some growth in the enthusiasts, and it's very important. And it's an important part to our business. But we need new people, and we're only going to get new people if they have fun with the games.
but you're making fine games. Do you see that the collector segment is getting a little younger? I know the operator segment is kind of generational. A lot of them are, you know, one operator goes on to the kids or the people working for them. Is that age getting a little younger? And whereas it's the people buying pinball machines, there's new people coming in, right, to kind of offset.
We need to have new people coming in. It's the same problem we talked about Harley earlier.
Yeah.
Harley has an aging demographic, and they're doing everything they can with smaller bikes, with the V-Rod, with the 500 and 750, with blacked out instead of chrome to death bikes.
Right.
And they're doing everything they can to get a younger audience. And we need to do the same thing, or you guys will. If we don't continue making games for the street, there won't be enough games made. We're the only ones that make pro price games.
Right.
And that is needed for the street. You know, some of you guys will operate premiums, but most people, operators, will do just fine with a pro price game.
Yes.
If you got a location that's lots of enthusiasts, maybe you want the premium. But other than that, it's pro. If we don't get people playing it, then we can't make them. And then, you know, ultimately, the collectors will have games in the corner, and they will be true antiques. And they'll, you know, you all will say, don't play that. Don't play it. You know, don't play that. That's to look at. And what's the point of looking at a pinball?
And wood rails are still fun. Little flipper games are still fun, people.
Yeah.
Like Woe Nelly and PBR.
Yeah.
That's a really fun game.
Yeah.
Both those are fun. And PBR has really great call-outs, fun music.
Yeah.
It's the same platform and layout, but it is dynamically different.
Yeah.
I'm glad to see Dirty Donnie still making art and future projects, I hope.
Yeah.
Back 30 years ago, there were a lot of mutual big competitors. What did Stern do more right than wrong than that the other companies didn't do, maybe?
A couple things. One is we're tenacious. Two is we're private. Williams, great company, public company. Business was shrinking, and it's nowhere near the size it was. In the heyday, there was 100,000 pinball machines made in 93, in the modern heyday, 93. There's 10% of that or whatever now, maybe a plus or minus. There are so many other entertainments. You mentioned the iPhone and the
tablets and all this stuff.
So now, we are everything pinball. So we have digital games, which will introduce people to pinball, young people. We have virtual reality with Oculus, and by the way, I play better for VR than real, although Jody tells me it's because the ball's slow. We have, and then we have merchandise, and we have accessories and so forth. So everything pinball, which is what we need to do. We were making the right kind of game. Gottlieb wasn't. They got out earlier. Williams was a public company that really was in the slot, getting in the slot machine business. So that makes, for a public company, it makes more sense. We were tenacious and we were private.
My philosophy with technology is I grew up with it. I was 3 years old, or so. I crawled into a computer chair, then I learned how to walk. And technology to me, it's a tool, whereas to many people, it's new.
Yeah.
So eventually it'll become passe. They come back to the analog world, they find a bike, they go hiking, fishing, pinball. They'll start doing that again. That's my view, is that that's coming in vogue.
Yet, there's style changes that we think about as technology. There's style changes. Whenever we had a big change, a style change, whether it be adding ramps in Space Shuttle or dot matrix display versus a numeric or alphanumeric, now with the LCD, not a great big LCD, but a score LCD were there because we believe in a back glass.
Right.
But that will make other games look old. LEDs in games make, a lot of the people in our company didn't want LEDs. Oh, no, that's not pinball.
It's not classic.
Yeah, we'd rather have those yellow ugly lights at dull games. No, modern is technology, but it's a style change. So modern LEDs for lights is now our normal size LCD.
Are there new things in the works for development?
Yes.
I would like to connect games together to say, hey,
there's new
I want to compete.
In the works. There's new things in the works.
Stuff that people are internally excited about.
We have, actually, you know, you talk about connecting games. We have, I bought for George to have in the building two of the NBA fast breaks.
You bought one from one of my friends.
Oh, did I?
In Jacksonville.
Okay.
Well, Marco bought it from one of my friends and shipped it up to you guys.
Yeah,
so
okay.
Is that part of this future technology, so to say?
We'll see.
Okay. Well, that would be nice. I know you can't disclose future games, but the hugest rumor is Star Wars, and whether or not that game comes out, how excited is your team, your development team of games, about future titles that they're working on right now? Are they really excited?
Of course they're excited about their titles. One of the things that we have to do is do titles that have the creative juices flowing of the, so they have to be interested in it. And Curly's trying to get us out of here, I can tell.
Well, I got my last statement. My last statement is congrats on 30 plus years.
30
of
plus
Stern.
Now. Yeah.
Pinball would not be around without Stern. And cheers to many, many, many more.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It's a statement about all the people who work on those games. It's a living, but it's also, besides a vocation, it's an avocation.
It's a great team. Everybody there is awesome, nice, fun, and it's a really eclectic environment, and that's one of the X factors that makes it work.
And if, remember, if you, whoever's watching this, we do tours. If you're in Chicago area, come on by.
Well, thank
Love
you very
to
much.
What we're doing. Thank you.
You have great customers. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.